اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم جی آیا نو پخیر آگلے نیہاو چاو چونہ شمے وشملے اوہائے گنزائمز گوٹر موگن اولا بو یور پریویت کئی فحال حالی شمہ چطورے اہلن وسالن مرحبا بونا موچو گراسیا سوابیا بھلی کرے آیا and the other one was
Hosh
Galdin and then there was another
Anayo
one
Anayo Hasayo
Anayo Hasayo as well and thank you very much everybody for tuning into PTV World you're certainly watching what this morning Now, so the very well learned and the one with the great memory, who happens to be Ms. Hajra Sati. I happen to be Shahzad Hassan Khan. We hope and pray that everybody out there is doing wonderfully well. The weather in Islamabad is turning out to be very fantastic. Well, it's not raining, but we do expect a little bit of rain today too as well. We hope and pray that you're ready to kickstart your day with us. First things first. Hello, Hajra. Anayo Hasayo.
Assalamu alaikum and thank you so much, you know, for giving me such a warm welcome and, you know, for introducing me such a nice way. I'm always humble.
Yeah, but there's one more thing which I wanted to ask, and that is that, you know, for a longer period of time, I've been introducing you as as a bookworm. I'm sorry to say that. Never wanted to say that, but you're always into books. You always come up with, hey, you know what, this is something I read, which is always very beneficial for our viewers too as well. It's been long that you haven't really shared any book, any review with us. Why? Why is that so?
That's true because I think it's like, you know, you are sometimes facing writer's block that, you know, the words are not coming out of you. I think I was facing the reader's block because I wasn't reading anything. But, you know, I started reading again and I have something to share with you.
Really?
Since you keep asking me, you know, about the books and stuff.
I'm excited.
Okay, so Shahzad, you have been to London, right?
Yes.
And have you seen the Kohinoor, the diamond?
Well, I'll be honest over here. So I've been to London almost 8 or 9 times in my life. And, you know, so every time I go over there, right in front of the Buckingham Palace.
Right.
You know, if you face towards the Buckingham Palace, on your left-hand side, there's a fortress type of a building.
Right, right.
Whenever I pass by that, you know, my cousin always tells me that, hey, you know, that's where the Kohinoor is being kept. So I haven't seen it with my naked eye, but I know where it's been kept.
Okay.
But why do you ask?
That's nice because, you know, I read a book about the Kohinoor.
All right.
And it used to be one of the world's largest diamond.
Yeah.
But there are some diamonds, you know, who came afterwards. They are the most largest one. But still, you know, it's in the crown. It's in the British crown. But it is claimed by the 4 countries, which is Pakistan, India, Iran and Afghanistan. Right.
Yeah.
And a lot of people say that, you know, it has a very cursed history because
wherever
this diamond goes, the trail of the blood, violence and, you know, murder, greed follows it, right? Diamonds, I like that, I guess, you know, because they're one of the most precious metal or material.
Everybody wants them, you know, and they say that diamonds are the best friends of the ladies too as well.
I really don't get it why people are so crazy after diamonds. I mean, people fight over rivers. Okay, I get it because, you know, water is the lifeline, right? People do fight over the food, of course, because it is one of the most essential. But diamond, I really don't get it because, you know, you can't eat it or you can't, you know, get some benefit out of it. But anyways, so this book is written by William Dalrymple. And it tells us a tale about, you know, how it fell into the hand of Mughals. And it was commissioned into a peacock throne, which was commissioned by Mughal Empress Shah Jahan. And afterwards, the empire fell into disarray because an emperor from the Iran, Nader Shah Durrani, invaded Delhi. He sacked Delhi and he took the diamond away as a most prayer and the precious diamond.
Yeah.
It went into the Iran and afterwards he met a very brutal end because, you know, he was assassinated. And his one of the most loyal guard, he took it to the Iran and Kandahar and there he established a dynasty over there. Afterwards, it came to the Sikhs' hands because Sikhs then sacked the Afghans and, you know, they conquered the Punjab. And from Punjab, it went into the hands of British India because Sikhs were defeated by the British. So it has a very important and a very interesting history. The boat which was carrying it to the London from the Bay of Bombay.
And they say that, you know, it actually went to hell. That's what they say.
Yes, they went to hell because one person on board got cholera and infected a lot of other passengers. So 135 crew members were found dead on the board. And
the diamond still survived.
The diamond survived, but and the ship was near the Mauritius, but Mauritius refused any help and they even threatened to fire. Why? Because they said that we are not going to, you know, we have nothing to do with the cholera infected crew members. But then it reached the London and it also met the some gale and storm and, you know, it barely survived. And then it went to the British crown. And then, you know, British used to say the sun never sets in the empire. But, you know, we have seen that, you know, sun already set in, right?
You know, so, we said certainly might have a disagreement with that one as well, but we'll talk about it some other day. But yes, you know, your spectacles just got famous, and I think your cup of tea looked fantastic. It was a picture taken by you, right?
No. I just, you know, pulled it off from the Google. I didn't take it.
All right, but it's perfect. Thank you very much for sharing. So for anybody who actually wants a good read, ladies and gentlemen, we have suggested you one. Please make sure that you do that. But I think it's about time that we take a look what's happening in the country and outside the country on the international and the national square. So first up, obviously, Shandoor Festival was taking place. It ended up as well, where I believe, to be very honest, you know, since I happen to be a polo player myself, you know, this is one of the most stunning places to actually have a polo festival or polo matches as well. Defending champion Chitral clinched the title of Shandoor Polo Festival. The three-day polo festival concluded in Upper Chitral Valley, Shandoor. The final match was played between Chitral A and Gilgit Baltistan A. Chitral A clinched the title after winning the final match by 10-9 goals. Frontier Corps North Major General Adil Amin was the chief guest of the final match. A large number of spectators witnessed the thrilling final match. Wow, that's fantastic. I just love it. And the way they play, I think they just play without rules. Yes. Most of the time, this is how I witness it. And you know, there's one more sport which is actually close to polo, and people in Afghanistan play it quite a lot as well, and that's buzkushi. Okay. So what they do is they do not have sticks or balls. They actually have goats in their hands, and you know, the other team actually has to snatch the goat from you while riding onto the horse and put it in a post as well. So buzkushi and polo both are games which actually include horses.
Right. Yes. So earlier on we were talking about the Britishers. So a young British mountaineer, Adriana Brownlee, has scaled Nanga Parbat, the ninth highest peak in the world, with other foreign climbers, and eyes claiming the title of the world's youngest climber to summit all 14 8,000ers. The 22-year-old British mountaineer reached the mountain's peak on Saturday afternoon in her eighth summit of an 8,000 meters above high mountain in the quest to scale all the highest peaks. Meanwhile, Pakistani mountaineer Sheroz Kashif, who is also 2 years younger than the Brownlee, is in the middle of making it to the summit of Nanga Parbat.
Wow.
And you know, Shehzad, what? He is also aiming for the same title, and is likely to summit.
And he's youngest as well.
Yes.
Wow, it's wonderful. So, you know, best of luck to everybody who's out there summiting. And, you know, we have shared one more fantastic news that this year around it was 1,400 or more climbers coming to Pakistan. Right. So, yes, on the front of tourism, Pakistan is doing wonderful under the new regime. But not just that. Imagine, so for the people of the Twin Cities, Rawalpindi and Islamabad, there's a good news. And that is that PMLN government, day in, day out, they're working hard. They're making sure that we really need to kind of facilitate the population within the country. So, imagine that more than 30 blue, orange and green buses came down, where they will be separately riding on different routes, making sure that they are going to facilitate the residents of the Twin Cities as well. So we have a small package. Go ahead, take a look. Thank you very much, PMLN, for thinking about the people of Pakistan. Let's do this.
People-friendly government always bring people-friendly projects. Blue and Green Line Metro Bus Service is such another stunning comfort for commuters of Rawalpindi and Islamabad by the PMLN government, who have been braving the humiliating attitude of local private transport mafia. This latest mass transit system would turn out to be a sigh of relief for them. The Blue and Green Line Metro Bus Service will be operated along with the regular traffic till the construction of new designated tracks for this purpose. The Blue Line service will operate from Korang Bridge Expressway to Faizabad Metro Bus Stop, covering Khoral Chowk, Khanna Pul and Dhokalahan. The Green Line will operate from Barhakot to Pakistan Institute of Medical Sciences PIMS stop, covering Appara, 7th Avenue and Zero Point. While Orange Line service will operate from H9 to New Airport, covering G9, G10 and Golamore.
It's a great initiative of the government, so it can help the traffic problems of Islamabad. So the people can travel easily, they can easily go to their work and save time and save energy as well.
Well, I believe it's a good initiative because public transport is very important for a country to develop. If you see developed countries, very less people use public their own cars. They mostly use public transport. It has various benefits.
This is a very good initiative, especially for the lower person, to save his money, energy, fuel, time from the government of PMNRL.
All of them will also integrate with the Rawalpindi Islamabad Metro Bus Service, which will help commuters travel between Rawalpindi and Islamabad with ease and comfort. This initiative will make Islamabad the first city in Pakistan that will offer multiple connectivities linking all four corners of the city.
I think as a citizen of Islamabad, it's a great initiative by PM Land Government and the Capital Development Authority and for launching such a healthy mechanism by providing these bus services.
In Islamabad, green and blue buses is very nice service.
This is a good initiative from Government of Pakistan. It is cheaper than other kind of vehicles.
It is hoped that this will not only help resolve traffic and environmental issues, but will also introduce a new trend in public travel. This kind of mass transit system has been developed in line with international practices as the best public transport system around the world, or heavily subsidized, making them viable and affordable for the service providers as well as the common man.
And in any developing country, ladies and gentlemen, you will always have such mass transit systems too as well, where, you know, they make sure that they're going to facilitate the population so that they can go to work, come back and be more efficient. And thank you very much, PM Olan, for thinking about the well-being of the people of Pakistan. Wonderful.
Right.
But now...
And I think this is one of the best tools to combat the climate change also, because, you know, the less we use our cars and our transports and more into the public transport, you know, that will decrease our carbon footprint. Right.
Yeah.
And now moving on to our final news, which is about the Alan Fakir, who was one of the biggest artists, right? And he's being remembered today. He was born in 1932 in Jamshoro district of Sindh, and he rose to fame singing Sufi songs comprising verses from Sufi saint Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai's poetry. Alan himself chose the Sufi Fakir role for his name. Alan Fakir, the singer of Huma, a fusion of pop and folk singing, not only took Pakistan to the center of the world music arena, but also led to his co-singer Muhammad Ali Sheikhi to new heights of popularity in the late 1980s. So have you listened to his songs?
Yes, I have. I have specifically listened to the one with Muhammad Ali Sheikhi Saab too. So Alan Fakir Saab, may your soul rest in peace, and patience for the entire family too as well. And yes, obviously, you know, people all over Pakistan and all over the globe, wherever they've heard you, you know, they miss you. And we are glad that your work is still around us so that we can feel you and we can sense you as well. You know, such is a contribution of such a great talented artist too as well. But now coming down to another point.
Okay.
And this is one thing, Haja, that I've always been thinking about, and that is that most of the time, you know, if my friends would give me compliment from the industry, they would be like, you know what, we might know that you're talented, but I think that you put in a lot of hard work.
Okay.
And I always took it as a compliment. I was like, okay, yaar, you know, if a friend is recognizing your effort, I think that's somewhere where you really need to acknowledge that, okay, yaar, shukar, alhamdulillah, somebody's saying something good about me. But then, you know, there's always this dialogue that, okay, talent does not beat hard work. In fact, you know, if you have talent and then at the same time you're putting in a lot of hard work with perseverance and consistency, you might end up, you know, as a legend. But then at the same time, if you do not have the talent, you lack the talent, but you are consistent with your hard work, you might beat the talent. What do you have to say?
Okay, so I wanted to pose a counter question to you. Can talent be polished? You know, if you deconstruct the concept of talent, it comes down to the intelligence that you have, right?
True.
And with whom you can, you know, polish your skills and, you know, have the success that you want. But is it always a God-gifted thing, or you can, you know, polish it, and, you know, is it a nature or your nurture?
You know, it's such a viable question, so I will not answer it, because we do have an expert over here in the studios. I would want him to answer that.
Of course.
But I will certainly share my take on this as well. But before we do that, ladies and gentlemen, you know, he's one of the most kindest people I've ever met in my career, and it's because of the fact that he always kind of, first of all, made sure that he's going to step into our shoes and then think and then say whatever we wanted, because as a university student, you know, there's not a lot of choices you have to yourself, you know. So to find a professor who's always thinking about your well-being as a student, I think it's great. He's a legendary, amazing person, you know. Till the time I've been in my university, he was always there, full of support, not just to me, but to each and every individual who was out there. And such is an example of a hard-working, talented human being. Ladies and gentlemen, we're very lucky that we've actually been joined with somebody who happens to be a lecturer at NUML University, and he is Mr. Asif Rasool. Hello, sir. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back. Good morning.
Walaikum assalam. Thank you very much. I'm very super excited to be on your show, because early in the morning, you just get such a warmth that it completely changes your
Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. Wonderful to have a teacher, a mentor, and a professor right in front of us.
Right.
But sir, let's get started. You know, so you've heard what Hajra asked me, that, you know, if you are hardworking, or do you think that the talent can actually be polished in the first place? If you break it down, it comes down to intelligence. And do you think that it can be polished, or do you think it's by nurturing, or is it by nature?
Well, this is a debate going on for internal time, and it will continue. But now we have got this Erickson research. He has provided a wonderful insight into this phenomenon, because people overrated talent. And he just, I like his study very much, because it is very systematic and it is backed by proper researches. And it's not only in one direction,
okay.
Sports. He just worked on almost every aspect of the life, whether it's teaching or sports or maybe like any other such field. So basically, it starts up with this point that when people think that, well, I'm very much talented, and they're not going to put a lot of efforts. So ultimately, the result is failure. He just gave a lot many examples, and he said that there is a master key.
Yeah.
And if you've got to unlock your talent, this is basically practice. And then he goes on to quote a lot many researches, and the first one is of this Mozart. Mozart was a child prodigy, a very famous musician. At very young age, like when he was three, he started composing symphonies and all that. By the time he was 13, he was a kind
master.
Of grown-up musician.
Yeah.
And people think that, well, he has got a lot of talent. Actually, when the researchers, they properly just looked into this phenomena, they came across that when he was around like 6 years old, he has practiced almost 3,500 hours
yeah.
into that. And then when he grew up, so this is how the studies in multiple direction, it concludes that basically it's your practice which brings difference. And it develops you as a virtuoso performer and elite performer.
Thank you very much for saying that, because you know, you very rightly mentioned that, you know, he might have dedicated 3,500 hours to practice, but there's this one research article which I studied and I read, in fact, and you know what it said? It said that if you want to master any skill, give it 10,000 hours of your life and you will be the master of whatever skill you've been practicing, and that's good. But sir, now the second counterpart is that, you know, she very aptly asked that, you know, whether is it the nature or the nurturing too as well. I believe when we talk about talent, it truly comes from nature, and it's because of the fact that it is within your own genes, you know, the way your elders were. And, you know, you might have that sense, you know, one way or the other, nobody's going to teach you. You might have that very beginning of whatever you wanted to do in your life
right.
from the nature's perspective, but then it certainly needs a little bit of nurturing. I mean, for example, if I talk about myself, because okay, before I talk about myself, let me talk about Cristiano Ronaldo. His son was sitting alongside him.
Okay.
Somebody interviewed him and was like, what are you going to tell your son? You know, what is more important? Is it talent or hard work? So he was like, you know, talent, okay, we get it, but it needs to be done with a lot of hard work.
Right.
You know, so this is the message he gave away. So talent only cannot really suffice you. Sometimes it might probably, because for all of those singers, we know Sair Ali Bagga, he's been playing instruments ever since he was a child. So he can play drum kits, he can play guitars, he can play flute, he can play anything. And you know, he's one of the best composers even over here, and he's composed songs across the border too as well. For me, you know, I think I've done more than 10,000 hours now as well when we talk about hosting. But as a kid, I was always hosting in my family programs. It wasn't really that, you know, I was hosting, but I was always cracking jokes, I was always on the stage, you know, probably talking to people. That did help me, but then to actually have that thin line, whether what to say on stage and what not to say on stage, came with practice and then a lot of learning too as well. So do you think that only if nature has gifted you with something will help you, or you will always need some sort of practice or hard work, or how do you polish that talent of yours?
Not some, a lot.
A lot, okay.
And this nature nurture debate, I would say that 70 or 80%, we have got to give this percentage to nurture, because it's opportunity which plays a very important role. For example, Shahzad having the same talent, had you been not in this family, or had you not been into such institute or in these environments
yeah.
or in these opportunities, you would have been sitting somewhere else.
True.
So this is like one, opportunity plays a very important role. Then obviously the environment which you are going to get. And especially the best thing is, for example, people who are going to have excellent acumen of mastery or of any of the thing. Basically, when you start digging deeper into any particular phenomena or any skill, a time comes when you develop a kind of mind eye. And it, whatever you see, basically the very clear representation is there inside your mind. And when it comes to your performance, so basically you have just got it from your environment, then like you got a wonderful place, very nice coaches who are going to guide you, and ultimately you become one of the best performers. And for this, he has just given, especially Ericsson has quoted a very good example of not one, rather many players. For example, Tiger Woods. Yeah. Tiger Woods' father says that when I believe in this thing, that if we are just going to engage in a very, very young age, so they are going to get it very quicker. And all the researches which he have shared about the young children, and now like in various fields, they are the top performers. Credit goes to that environment which the parents created, and even they practice a lot to learn and understand it, and then like they just made them initially practice with it, and ultimately when they saw that now we do not have sufficient knowledge to help our kid to grow more, then they hired highly skillful coaches for them. True. And from there they started growing up. So I would conclude, Hajra, okay, that basically this nurturing, it nature, plays a nature very important together role.
So effort, talent and luck, you know, these are the three ingredients, right? So which is more important when you talk about your success in your career or in your life?
All three of them, because you really have to be at the right place at the right time.
Exactly. And even now, I have seen even...
So what have you...
And only Allah can do that for you. Only Allah can do that for you.
You get two of the things and you don't get one of the things. And then what happens, you know?
Time is right, but you're not at the right place. You know, nothing's going to happen.
I have seen now... there's a lot of talk of luck in the literature, not in Eastern but Western literature as well.
Right.
That this luck, it plays a very important role.
Right.
Now I don't know how to like deduce it from it or what to say about it, but still they've just.
Sir, do you believe in luck yourself? Okay, let's start from here. Do you believe in luck yourself? I don't believe in luck.
I believe
in hard work. I believe in hard work. The belief system I carry is that you put in whatever is required of you and then leave the rest to Allah Almighty. That's it. You know, because if you get it, then Allah has surely made it that, you know, it will be your destiny. But if
no doubt, law of attraction works.
Yes.
But still, I would love to quote this one of the top jockey, and now he is one of the motivational speaker, Les Brown.
Yeah.
He said that when I was to become a jockey, I would go there and I would just imagine that what if he dies today?
Yeah.
And I was just hungry and I was dying for it. So one day I saw that my producer received a call that the guy is not coming, and I was like energetic like hell. I just got ready, I went inside and I said I'm going to do it. So basically this opportunity or this play also plays a very important role.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I mean, you won't get it.
Of course it plays an important role, because Shehzad, I'll tell you one thing. So I've met a lady, you know, she happens to be my mentor also.
Wow.
And her husband was in the Air Force, right? And he was a very good pilot, and he had a very bright career when it comes to that. So he was flying, and you know, some malfunctioning happened to the plane and he had to eject, right?
What?
So he came down and he broke his backbone, and now he's in the wheelchair, right? So you know, he had a very good career trajectory, but you know, fate had something else destined for him, right? And this is, you know, sort of a negative example of how the fate or the luck, you know, could lead you to the different places. But at the same time, they're also very, you know, positive examples, you know, of how you grab the opportunities and how you become successful, right?
And then at the same time, you might even have, you know, real examples of, you know, pilots, you know, who might have saved a fighter jet, you know, probably from falling down too as well, you know,
so,
and they might have another career. For example, you know, that cup of tea which costed Indians quite a lot, right? You know, Abhinandan was here. So imagine, you know, his trajectory was supposed to go down, but what they did, they
it could happen otherwise.
Yeah, yeah,
right?
Exactly. But now what I wanted to ask was that, imagine that in life, you do come across situations, sir, where, you know, if we are honest to ourselves and if we do our fair analysis, we will certainly see people more talented and more hardworking than us, but not probably at the position where they might want to see themselves, or we might expect of them as well that, yeah, you know, they're super talented. Why? And what's wrong? You know, so how do we answer that? So the talent is there, the practice is there, but then unfortunately they were not able to achieve what they wanted to achieve in their life. So then what do we take out of it?
Exactly, opportunity. For example, for example, all top football players,
yep,
Brazil, They got into that area. Now, luckily, had they been born somewhere else, like India and Pakistan, do you think that despite this fact that they have got a little talent and they were unable to, then we got like a table tennis player, one street of UK. It produced more than 100 top players. Okay. Wow. Now, same goes to like China. They've got that kind of environment and people are just coming out of it. So, we've got these all Formula One drivers. They've got a specific place. Where they just get the opportunities, especially the best coaches are there, and they go for the purposeful practice, and this really brings them to the top. So opportunity. It plays
Sir, with China, it's different. You know, in China, I've seen this documentary where, you know, they admit like 5-year-old kids, you know, into their Olympics academy, and then from there onwards till the next 16 years, they will be training all of those children, whether talented or not. You know, so there's no way going out as well, and that the only focus of all of those kids who actually enter that academy is to kind of compete in Olympics. That's it, you know, so that's the kind of process they have. Even if you talk about Pakistan, we have academies, we have high performance centers over here where people go, so which is why, you know, the facility we have provided, we get more cricketers, right? If we certainly would have provided opportunities for other sports, we might have seen other legendary sportsmen too as well. For example, Janshir Khan Saab, Jahangir Khan Saab, you know, for all of those people who have done tremendously well. I think it's about the environment people get, you know. So imagine, you know, Haja was born in a family where book reading was a norm, you know, so
no.
She said no,
no.
Okay. You know, but she picked up on it herself too as well. She wanted to do so. So, and same is the case with us. We will continue on this, but we actually have to head out towards a short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. And you know, earlier on we were having a debate on the nature and the nurture, and since a very esteemed guest said that it's a very long debate, you know, it has been there, you know, since the times of eternity. So we would like to, you know, take his closing remarks on, you know, what is his opinion about it, and you know, what should we do in order to find the success, which is a very $1 million question. But you know,
should we only live totally dependent on talent, or do you think that we really need to put in the hard work as well?
My take is that we have got to develop a culture of this hard work, a lot of practice, because there are two different types of mindset. We have got open mindset and we have got closed mindset. So people with this closed mindset and they believe in talent, if they are going to practice something a little and if they fail, they always think that, well, I lack talent, and they won't be able to improve in that area. But if they we just put into the practice that with a lot of practice I can just improve, so with a few failures they'll still, they muster up their courage and they are going to carry it on. So we have got to ultimately, I'll conclude, we have got to develop the culture of practice over talent.
All right, that's wonderful. And one last question, sir, and the only answer you can give is either yes or either no, okay? And then the later part, you know, obviously, on one of the shows, we'll talk about it again. So do you believe in fake it till you make it?
Yes.
Yes. All right, with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're actually bidding Sir Asif Rasool a farewell too as well. Thank you very much, sir, for taking our time and talking about such an important topic, because talent mixed with hard work, ladies and gentlemen, will take you to places, and perseverance and consistency and being thankful to Allah Almighty. We are heading out towards a short break, but when you guys will come back, I certainly want to thank TikTok, YouTube, and all of these social media platforms, because they have increased a lot of inclusivity, and that too in terms of diverse people from diverse religions. And you know, imagine, so everybody's on mainstream and everybody come out stronger, smarter, and be a superstar, you know. So we will have a superstar over here in the studios with us right after a short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Good morning. It is a good morning. Yes, right. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
watching PTV World.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, finally the moment is here where I said that TikTok, YouTube, I'm very thankful for these platforms to have existed, because when we talk about a society, our society is represented by all its members, you know. So may it be a Muslim, may it be a Hindu, may it be a Christian. On the other front, may it be a Nigerian, may it be an African, may it be an Asian, may it be somebody from States.
Right.
You know, so it obviously, society is all about us coming together, and these platforms have provided an equal opportunity to each and every individual. And this person took advantage of this opportunity, made himself a star. He's finally on TV, TikTok, YouTube, he's singing songs, and he's doing whatever he wanted to do in his life. He's got over a million subscribers and views on his TikTok too.
Impressive.
As well. Ladies and gentlemen, we're very lucky that we've actually been joined by Abiola Moshood. Hello, assalamu alaikum, good morning, how are you?
Wa alaikum salam, good morning, thanks for having me.
Thank you very much for joining us, wonderful to have you. But first things first, how did you end up in Pakistan?
Wow, good question. So my dad used to be in Pakistan before then, while I was in Nigeria. And then he came back to Nigeria, like after a long time. I used to see my dad back then on just some pictures. But finally he came back to Nigeria. And then it was like I can come and study, continue my study there. And I just finished my college over there.
Yeah.
So I just want to stay with my dad. So I didn't even know wherever he was. I was like, I'll come with you.
Yeah.
And that's how I ended up in Pakistan.
And that's how you ended up in Pakistan. But imagine, so for how long have you been living in Pakistan?
It's been around 10, 11 years now.
So it's been 10, 11 years and you're already so hooked to dal mash. Yeah? You know, so I think most of the time, whatever you've eaten is dal mash, right?
Yeah.
Dal mash, makhan, you know, these are part of our culture too as
yes.
well. And imagine, guess what? So Abiola thought about singing and imagined that he came up with a song and titled it Dal Mash. And there's a lot of interesting story to it too as well. We're going to share his music video and music with you. Please go ahead, take a listen. I bet that this morning, ladies and gentlemen, is going to be a fantastic morning. Only if you're going to have Dal Mash with makhan. All right, let's do this. Let's take a listen.
Dal mash kilado, menu dal mash kilado, dal mash.
Be back on screen. All right, dal mash menu khila deo, roti mugya thodi la deo. Wow, that's a good one. I mean, it certainly makes us feel that you've been eating dal mash quite a lot and you love it. So you do not want to eat biryani. The only thing you want to eat is dal mash. Why is that so?
Well, I like the food, dal mash, and more than that, I took it up. I get attached to a word sometimes. Then I like being an entrepreneur, I also brand it as well. In fact, dal mash has a website itself, dalmash.com. And
I think it's the best answer to the inflation too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's cheaper, by the way. Like,
you know, obviously, you know, so while I was listening to this song, it was well received by the audience as well, and you've taken good chances with the opportunity all of these platforms have provided.
Yeah.
But back in the day, how did it all started? You know, what pushed you to be a singer, an actor, performing artist?
So, like, I have diverse talents. And obviously, I get this a lot of time. Like, why do you do so many things? Why not been focused? So, but then I felt like, look, the thing is, I happen to be good at this thing. So, yeah. I felt it would be the only sane thing to do is just make advantage of this strength I have.
Yeah.
So, I was that, like, I'm multi-talented. Like, I can help it. So, I just... I have to explore those places.
And in addition to that, you know, so you have a very different market. You're creating a very different market for your audience. And that is why, because, you know, so there's this very amazing page, you know, we all follow it, Interracials. So you came up with Inter Chavals too as well.
Yes, Inter Chavals.
So why do you want to market yourself like that in the first place?
Okay, so Inter Chavals, by the way, okay, so we're three guys who run this channel. Me, Ismail, is from Burundi, he's from Africa as well. And then a Pakistani, he was my friend in university. He's a guy, but his name is Iraj Alam, but like, female name. But we came up with this name. So he came up with this name. It was like, okay, Interrace, Inter Chavals. And then we thought, okay, why not just make funny videos? And day after the other, we post one video at a time, and luckily one of our videos got viral, and then that's when it went up from there.
And it took up, and not just that, imagine, so he's singing, he's making videos on TikTok, and just very recently Usman Vazir actually conducted an entire boxing event in Gilgit-Baltistan. It was jam-packed, people flew from across the borders to come over here and witness it, and you were there in the ring boxing.
Yes.
That's true.
Absolutely.
But you certainly do not look like a boxer to me. I'm sorry to say that. But yeah, what was it? Or were you just there to entertain people?
No, my opponent wasn't entertained. I fought.
And you won.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
You won the boxing match.
Yes, yes.
I think it comes to you guys naturally. Yeah. You guys do scare us at times as well with those punches. But because let's talk about Muhammad Ali, let's talk about Mike Tyson, let's talk about Floyd Mayweather.
Yeah.
All of those people come from the same place.
Yes.
And you know, you do scare us with your punches. So, but please make sure that your punches are restricted to the ring too.
Yeah,
well.
Absolutely.
I think that's very important.
I know, absolutely.
But how did you end up boxing?
So boxing, it's kind of a thing I was good at as well. Like, okay, back in Nigeria, I never did boxing professionally, but we used to have this, you know, university for between
was
friends.
Was the standard lower here? Or do you think?
It started professionally in Pakistan, actually. All right. And this is my third professional fight in Pakistan. I lost my first two, for the records.
But you still won.
But I won this is my first
how
professional
How many rounds win. Did it take you?
This is the fourth round, and it was
and
a four-round bout
did you
anyway.
Take?
I'm sure it took a lot. I actually look at the match.
How was it? Did you black out or something?
Like, no. I dominated the match entirely. Like, that's the good part. I controlled the match entirely, and it was... You know, I used this attack as my weapon, and it was a very interesting match. I love this.
Is it a left hook or a right hook?
Both. He had all of it. I gave him a right hook, I gave him a straight punch, gave him an uppercut, and you know, it was a good combination altogether.
Oh, that's lovely.
That's wonderful.
So,
yeah.
So you are basically from Nigeria, and you know, you're very well versed with our Pakistani culture. So you know, what are the two similarities that you see between the two countries?
Good question. The thing is, the similarities I'll say is more with the northern part of Nigeria.
Right.
Maybe, I would say maybe because they're more Muslim concentrated in the northern part of Nigeria, but like if you go there, you would actually probably feel like, oh, I'm in some part of Pakistan, like literally. So, there's like even the clothes, I'll tell you, like they wear similar clothes. I don't want to go far, but like there's a lot of similarities, trust me. And I have a few friends that, like, Ibrahim is from, like, northern part, and he gets along really well here. And I get along as well, but I'm like, he's, like, he really embraced as well. So there's a lot of similarities, plus Karachi used to be the former capital, Lagos used to be former capital in Nigeria as well.
Okay.
And then Abuja is not the current capital, like Islamabad, but this place also look alike as well. There's a seaport in Lagos, there's the seaport in Karachi as well. Those are the similarities, one of the similarities I've seen.
Yeah,
well,
that's wonderful. And does husband and wife fight back there in Nigeria too as well quite often?
Yeah, but then the wives are more stronger.
Well, obviously, for sure, yeah. Even the men are very strong. But just in addition to that, you know, while we were talking about it, you know, before the show, you were actually talking in and speaking fluent Punjabi and Urdu too as well.
Yeah.
You know, so why don't you know, for our viewers in 46 different countries, why don't you share some of your Punjabi semantics as well? So please go ahead. You know.
Well, okay. And since you say that, I can.
Can you sing the Punjabi? I
can sing Punjabi. You can sing Punjabi.
You can sing Punjabi. You can sing Punjabi. You can sing Punjabi. You can sing
Punjabi. You can sing Punjabi. You can sing Punjabi. ਤੁਸੀਂ ਜਦੀ ਅਸਿੰਦੇ ਹੋ ਸਜਣਾ ਸੰਦੇ ਸੀਨੇ ਠੰਡ ਪੈਂਦੀ ਕਿ ਸਾਡਾ ਦਿਨ ਨਹੀਂ ਚੜਦਾ ਉਹ ਜਦੀ ਜਦੀ ਤੱਕ ਨੇ ਨਾ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਸਾਡੇ ਲਈ ਇਹ ਦੁਪਹਿਰੇ ਵੀ ਉਦੋਂ ਤੱਕ ਰਾਤ ਹੀ ਰਹਿੰਦੀ
And he's smiling more than Hazesh. I think it's wonderful. But now what I actually wanted to ask you about was that obviously, you know, the audience out there loves your content. And you've always been very real and honest with that too as well. So your newer song is coming and it says No Rush. And all of a sudden from Dal Marsh to No Rush is from very comic version of your music to very serious version of the music, which obviously has a greater audience too out there as well. Yeah. So what do you want to tell us about No Rush before we share the teaser?
Yes. Okay. So to be honest, I think I'm blessed. I find myself, like, I have a big audience to cater for. Like, I mean, exactly. I mean, look at the audience in Nigeria. It's a big population. Africa as a whole is a big population. Yep. Then Pakistan, India, because Urdu is like for Pakistan, India, like this place. Yeah. So, and I think if you know the language, then you can communicate with that mass audience.
Right, right.
So these are the things I like. I know I love singing. And No Rush is a kind of a song with Montego. He's also a good artist from Nigeria as well.
Yes.
My fellow artist. So we went to the studio and we're like, okay, we came up with something really nice. And No Rush is a very nice song. It's a pop song. We've got this Afro beat. And then we've got my friend Myra in that as well, featured as a model. And I mean, we had some of the shoots in F9 Park.
Right.
So I love whenever there's any kind of way I can have this cultural fusion, I always enjoy it because, like you say, like it's always like unity and, you know, this diversity. And it's always beautiful when you show culture. And this is what I love to, you know, stand
for. So what's the message we are going to get from No Rush?
Well, No Rush won't have like particular that much maybe moral message, but then it's more of me celebrating success. It's more of me celebrating No Rush. What's the fuss? Like it's more.
All right. Well, you know, why don't we take a look at the teaser? Hey, can we play the teaser? Let's take a look at the teaser of No Rush coming out on. When is it coming out?
On Eid.
On Eid, all right. We're waiting for that too as well. You know, imagine the Bakra saying, No Rush. hold it, you know, No Rush. Yeah, all right, let's go, let's take a look.
No Rush, what's the fuss? Plenty money, team we got rich. Let's talk, who's the boss? Either way, make it us, I think you lost. Oh yeah, don't touch, it's not yours. She gotta go, please give her the act. Oh shit.
So on Bakra Eid, ladies and gentlemen, Abiola is actually coming up with a single alongside Montego Scott, and that the title of the song is No Rush. I like the music, and even with Dal Marsh, the music was fantastic too as well. And you're doing a great job. So anything towards the end you want to say to our audiences, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much for the love and support. I mean, Pakistan is my second home, and I thank you for the love and support. I think for me, all what I've gotten from Pakistan, I think it's getting to the stage. I've always loved to give back, and I'll be giving back in different capacities since I'm also a motivational speaker as well. So, I mean, there's a lot.
Is there anything you've left behind?
Absolutely.
You're like, I'm going to experiment.
So stay tuned, inshallah. I'll keep bringing, stay inshallah. Tuned and keep watching us. We'll keep bringing you great stuff. And by the way, there's a lot to share, but I won't go there. Wish to End is a project that we've also like been working on, and owned by Asin Rao, and it's also like it's for waste management and managing waste at waste source bifurcation. Well, that's a lot to share, but again, I'll keep it for another day.
Thank you very much, Abiola, for joining us. Wonderful to have you over here, and believe you me that, you know, this platform over here at PTV World this morning, we will always welcome you with arms wide open, because this platform is for all of those people who are out there who are talented, and we certainly want to showcase their talent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.
Best of luck, and we will certainly have you on the show again too as well.
Thank you so much.
And ladies and gentlemen, that's the beauty, you know, that over here, you know, on a channel which is actually state-owned, the best part is that we almost every single day get directions that we really need to be inclusive. And this is an example, you know, so we've had people from Kazakhstan, Germany, Russia, US, England. I mean, I think I've had people from more than 100 countries over here on the show today as well. I feel blessed to have this opportunity to be meeting people as well, because that's where you learn the most too as well. With that, we're actually heading out. Till the next time.
Till the next time. It's a goodbye. Well, good morning.
Good morning.